Homage to,
homage to
the Buddha's Flower Garland Sutra,
of great expansive teachings,
and the ocean-wide
Flower Garland Assembly
of Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. The unsurpassed, deep, profound, subtle, wonderful Dharma in 100,000 million eons is difficult to encounter. Now that I've come to receive and hold it within my sight and hearing, I vow to fathom the thus come one's true and actual meaning.
上人、各位法师，还有各位佛友，大家阿弥陀佛。今天是2013年11月30日，星期六的晚上。现在我们是在加州伯克莱圣寺，一起来研究《大方广佛华严经》实地品。那现在我们已经研究到第五地南圣地。
Okay, the Venerable Master, all Dharma Masters, and all Dharma friends, Amitava. Today is November 30th, 2013, Saturday evening, and we're here at the California Berkeley Buddhist Monastery investigating together the Buddha's Flower Garland Sutra, and we're currently on the 10th grounds.
今天我们会从这个本质上第42页的中文开始来研究起。 英文会在第43页，那么所以首先我们会把这个中文的经文跟英文的经文先读一遍，然后我们再来解释。So
today we'll be beginning from page 42 for the Chinese and page 43 for the English. And so first we will be reading the sutra text together and then we'll investigate on the explanation.
请大家合掌。佛子，此菩萨摩诃萨以如是智慧观察，所修善根，皆为救护，一切众生，利益一切众生。 安乐一切众生，哀悯一切众生，成就一切众生，解脱一切众生，摄受一切众生，令一切众生离诸苦恼。 令一切众生普得清净，悉皆调伏，入般涅槃。
Okay, so now we'll be reading the English. So could everybody read together with me? Disciples of the Buddha, this Bodhisattva, Mahasattva, in that way uses wisdom such as those and contemplates the good roots cultivated as all for the sake of rescuing and protecting all living beings. For the sake of bringing benefit to all living beings, for the sake of making all living beings happy, out of sympathy and pity for all living beings, in order to bring all living beings to accomplishment, to liberate all living beings, to gather in and receive all living beings, to free all living beings from all sufferings and afflictions, to bring all living beings universally to attain purity, to cause all living beings to be tamed and subdued, and to bring all living beings to enter parinirvana.
佛子是菩萨摩诃萨，那么现在讲的这个菩萨呢，是第五地南胜地的菩萨，他用如是智慧观察，他是用这种智慧来观察他所修的善根。那么一般我们众生，当我们在做任何事情或是观察事情的时候，我们并不是用真正的智慧，我们用的是四智变通。 就是用我们的分别心，因此我们所观察出来的，都不是真正的一种观察，而是一种分别或是一种我执我见，跟菩萨用智慧来做观察是截然不同的。那菩萨呢，因为他有了智慧，所以他观察的结果，他发现他所修的善根啊，都是会增长的，而且呢，这些善根。 都是为了来帮助众生，利益众生。菩萨没有一丝一毫的自私心，因此呢，他的菩萨道才能够行得很究竟。Okay,
so the sutra goes, disciples of the Buddha, this Bodhisattva Mahasattva. So this Bodhisattva in that way uses wisdom such as those and contemplates the good roots cultivated. So here we see that this Bodhisattva of the fifth ground, the ground of difficult conquest, is able to use such wisdoms in order to help rescue and protect all living beings. So for us ordinary living beings, when we do something or when we contemplate something, we do not use true wisdom. Instead, we use this kind of worldly wisdom, which is actually the mind of distinction. And so this is not the true contemplation either. We are just making distinctions and we are becoming attached to the self and having our own different kinds of views. So this is much different from that of the Bodhisattva. The Bodhisattva does not contemplate in this way because the Bodhisattva sees that all good roots are increasing and he is using these good roots, the cultivation of the good roots, for the sake of rescuing and protecting living beings. So because the Bodhisattva does not have even a sliver of selfishness, that is why he is able to ultimately practice the Bodhisattva path.
一般的这个根有两种，一种是有形，像花草树木的根，它是有形有相的。这个根呢，可以让这个树或是花草能够增长，那么它能够长得繁茂，也是因为它的根生了。 那如果人的善根生了，善根生后了，那么他呢所行所作就会很如法，而且他在菩提道上就这个障碍会比较少，因为善根生的人呢，就像一棵树，那个根如果生了，那么 不管是刮大风或是呢、下大雨，这个根呢生的这种、枝叶花果就不受影响，也不会因为呢风吹了就倒了。那因此呢，如果我们的善根很深厚的时候呢，我们在修行道上不容易退转，而且呢很容易得到这种解脱。
Okay, so there are in general two types of roots. The first are those that are visible. So these include the roots of plants, of flowers, of trees, of grass. And when these plants or flowers or all these various kinds of plants, they are able to increase or grow or flourish, it is because their roots have deepened. Similarly, when we are practicing, when we are cultivating, our good roots also deepen. And when they deepen, our practice of the Bodhisattva path is much easier, and we will not encounter so many obstacles. So we are just like these trees. So if the tree has deep roots, then no matter how strong a wind or how bad a storm it encounters, it will be able to stand firm, and its leaves and fruits and branches will not be affected. And the tree also will not fall down because of bad storm. So we also, if we have deep roots of goodness, then we will not retreat easily from the path of cultivation, and will also attain liberation easily.
人的善根呢，有这个世间的善根，也有出世间的善根。那么世间的善根是什么呢？像我们孝顺父母、恭敬师长，或是呢救济穷人，或是呢广行善事。这些呢都是世间的善根，那么世间的善根呢，也是出世间善根的一个基础。因此，上人就讲说，人道尽，佛道成。如果我们世间的善根如果没有做好，不能成就，那么出世间的善根一样没有根基了，也不容易成就。如果我们看宣公上人，他是一个孝子。他从十二岁开始，每天呢给父母叩头顶礼，然后呢到十九岁的时候，他母亲往生了，还在母亲的坟墓上守孝三年，那么因此人家称他叫白孝子。那在中国来讲呢，这个孝是一切这种所谓这种道德的根，这种根本。如果一个人的有孝顺的这种心了，行孝了，那么他的道德呢，这个根就生出来了。所以呢，上人因为他行孝，所以呢，他自己的这种德的根本有了以后呢，他要修行就很容易成就了。
So living beings, we also are able to develop good roots.And good roots also can be divided into the worldly good roots and those that are transcendental. So for worldly good roots, they include being filial to our parents, being respectful to our elders, helping the poor, and in general, performing wholesome deeds. And so all these are classified as being part of the worldly good roots. And yet these worldly good roots are a basis for our transcendental good roots. Because as the Venerable Master said,When we fulfill the path of a human, then we will have achieved Buddhahood. So by practicing the path of the person, then we can gradually be able to achieve on our path of cultivation as well. Because if we cannot be a person well, then we will not be able to easily fulfill the path of a Buddha. So if we see the Venerable Master, he was a very filial son. At the age of 12, he began to bow to his mother and father.And at the age of 19, when his mother passed away, he stayed by his mother's grave for 3 years in order to fulfill his filial practice. And thus, he was called filial son by all the people around him. And so in Chinese culture, we see that filiality is the basis or the fundamentals for all virtuous practices. And by having and practicing filiality, then the way will grow.And so if we can practice filiality, if we can practice being a person, then our cultivation will be much easier.
那么出世间的善根是什么呢？出世间的善根也是很多。如果我们 啊，每天晚上诵阿弥陀经，你就会看到说有五根，这五根呢，啊，也是一种善根。这个根呢是出世间的善根，这五根就是啊，信根、净根、念根、定根、慧根。信就是对我们对出世间法深信了，对佛讲的经典教理完全呢没有怀疑了，那这就是一种信根。如果我们信得越深，那么我们将来呢就不容易呢在对这个佛法有任何一丝一毫的怀疑。那么净根是什么呢？净就是精进，精进呢就是不懒惰、不懈怠、不放逸。那么身呢要精进，心也要精进，就是说我们的身体呢疲累了，但是呢我们还可以再继续精进，我们在病中也可以精进，我们在往生啊就快死了都可以继续精进。那这种精进呢是啊为了这个了生死的，所以呢身要精进，心呢要精进。因为我们的心呢啊如果不修行的话，我们的心就像一只猴子一样，它是怎么样啊，这个活蹦乱跳的，很难驾驭，很难控制。所以呢怎么来驾驭我们的心，怎么收摄我们的六根，这就是一种啊需要透过精进的修行。比如说我们要念佛，我们要持咒，我们要拜佛，我们要诵经，那做种种佛事，这就是一种心的精进。
So there are also various kinds of transcendental good roots. And so every night when we recite the Amitabha Sutra, you will find that it says five roots. And these five roots are all types of good roots, and they're also transcendental. So these five roots are faith, vigor, mindfulness, samadhi, and wisdom. So the first one is faith. Faith is referring to our having no doubts. We have complete faith in Buddhism. And the more we have faith in the religion, the more that we will be able to restrain ourselves from having any doubts in the future. So that is the root of faith. Then we have vigor. So vigor refers to not being lazy, not being lax, not being casual. And this is also referring to both the body and the mind. And so for the body, even when we're ill, we can be vigorous. And even when we approach the end of life, we can still be vigorous. And for this vigor in the body is for the sole purpose of ending birth and death. So that is vigor in the body. Vigor of the mind is referring to our cultivation. And so if we do not cultivate, then our minds will run around like a monkey. So the monkey is very wild and it jumps and it's very hard to control. So that is why we must try to restrain our mind as well as our six organs. So how do we do this? We must recite the Buddha's name. We must recite mantras. We must bow to the Buddhas. We must recite sutras. All these various methods are in order for us to restrain and keep in control our minds. So that is vigor of the mind.
第三是念根。这个念呢，我们都知道我们这个念头呢是很维系的。比如说一个念头产生的时候，它会有四个过程的。这个四个过程叫生、住、意、灭。就是说那个念头产生了，那么接着呢它会怎么样住停留，你会在这个念头上产生一些执着了。可是呢这个念头呢住了以后呢它会坏意就是变异，开始呢产生一种变化了。变化了以后呢它会怎么样灭了，就是这个念头呢就消失了。那么其实所以呢每个念呢都是这样子的，每个念都有这个过程叫生住意灭。那生住意灭，我们众生的心呢是很粗的，就是因为平常呢我们都是六根向外持求，所以我们的心呢很粗，很难察觉这种心念的这种变化。那因此呢，如果我们能够有这种念根，就是在我们的念念之间我们都能够回光返照来关照我们的念头的时候，就会察觉到这些念头呢其实都是一种生灭法，它 它是无常的。 你一个念头生出来以后呢，会怎么样？念念相续。如果那个念很深，那你呢，这个念头呢，就一个妄想，一个妄想，接着打下去的。那事实上，这个我们的念头是不是这么维系呢？其实它是更维系的，因为在这个经论上就讲说呢，我们一个人每一个念里头呢，有90个刹那。 就是在一个念这么维系当中，还有90个刹那，90个生灭。那这一个刹那里头，还有900个生灭。那如果你再分析下去，就是说，我们人的一个念头里头，其实有81000个生灭，81000个生灭就是81000个生死。那你会觉得说，我一个念头，我对我来讲，就是好像一刹那之间，怎么有可能会有81000个生死呢？ 其实这个道理呢，也不难了解。就像现在，比如说，我在这里讲话，你把这个我的话呢录了音，你呢把这放到一个这种那种有关这种声音的这种软体上，你把它放大了，你就可以看到这个声音里头呢有很多这种那种波动的那种，就像电波一样，很微细的。 它是呢高低起伏震动的，随着我的音声高低，它就是这样。你去分析呢，原来一个声音里头呢，可以产生那么多微妙的变化。可是你现在坐在这里听，你听到的是一个声音，就是好像就是那么一点点声音而已。可是呢，你把它放到一个软体上去分析的时候，你可以把它放大，你看看里头的变化，就像我刚刚讲的，一念之中就是有这么多的生灭。 也表示说，在我们每个念头里头呢，其实我们打了很多妄想，我们自己都不知道为什么，因为观察不出来。所以，如果我们有那种念根的，就是这个根很深，我们常常观照我们每个念头。那每个念头呢，在生灭的时候呢，我们就知道这个妄想是怎么产生的，这个妄想是怎么停留的，这个妄想又是怎么在变化的、变异的。等到它变异到一个程度了，它又怎么幻灭？ 你就可以观照得到了。如果观照得到，那我们就知道有些妄想是不好的。什么妄想是不好的？我们打那种财色名食睡这五欲的这种妄想，那就是生死轮回的根本了。如果呢，我们的念头里头，我们这些念都是要念佛、念法、念僧、念戒，那这个都是一种出世间法。 所以你想想看，我们为什么要有念根？就是因为我们需要有正念。我们如果正念现前，那我们念念之间呢，都是叫做净念相继。如果你这个看过大势至菩萨这种念佛的圆通章，你就知道说，如果我们收摄我们的六根，我们的六根不向外持求了，那我们念佛的时候就能够净念相继。所以呢， 如果我们的念根呢，这个根深了以后，我们这个念呢都是正念，而且呢不容易打妄想。Okay,
so the next root is the root of mindfulness. And if we look at our own thoughts, we see that they are very subtle. And when they rise, when every thought rises, it actually undergoes 4 different processes. The first is becoming. The second is dwelling, the third is transforming, and the fourth is perishing. So becoming is when the thought first rises, and then after that it dwells, so we give rise to various attachments for that thought. Then it gradually decays or transforms, and then finally it perishes or it dies out. So all our thoughts are like this, but because our minds are dull, so that is why our 6 organs are all going outwards. And so that is why it is hard for us to detect the changes of our minds. And so every thought, if we can in every thought turn the light within and find that birth and death of every thought, then we will understand that all our thoughts are impermanent. And we'll see that thought follows another thought, and every thought that we have is just a false thought. And actually, it is much more subtle than just one thought after another thought. If we go even deeper, there are 90 kshanas within every thought. And there are also 900 births and deaths within every kshana. So we see that in one thought, there are 81,000 births and deaths. And so if we can know that, then we'll realize that even though one thought is so fast, there are in fact so many minute changes that occur, which are imperceptible for us. And so you might think, well, I think that one thought is so fast, how can there be so many different changes within? Well, the concept is not that difficult to understand. For example, I'm talking right now, and if you record it and you put it into a device to track the sound waves, you will find that my sound oscillates very rapidly. And for just one tiny sound, there can be so many subtle changes. And so even though you hear right now only a tiny sound, if you put it into the software, you will realize that there are so many different changes, or in the words of the thoughts, so many different births and deaths. So that is why one thought can undergo so many different changes. And if we give rise to many false thoughts throughout our daily lives, then we do not know, because we cannot see or perceive all these various changes. So that is why if we are able to contemplate our every thought and know how our false thoughts rise, know how our false thoughts dwell, know how our false thoughts transform, and know how our false thoughts perish, then we will know that some of these thoughts are bad. For example, if we think about the five desires, which are wealth, beautiful forms, fame, food, and sleep, then these are the fundamentals for birth and death, and we should refrain from them. And then we know that other thoughts are good if we are mindful of the Buddha, mindful of the Dharma, mindful of the Sangha, and mindful of the precepts. So these are all transcendental dharmas, and they are good, so we must maintain them. So this is the root of mindfulness. It is for us to maintain our proper thoughts. And in this way, we can have pure thought after another pure thought, instead of all having false thoughts. So if we look at a great strength bodhisattva's Dharma door, we see that he says that if we can return our six organs within, and if we can focus and contemplate on every thought, then we'll be able to have pure thought after another pure thought. So this is the root of mindfulness.
第四种是叫做定根，定就是一种正定、禅定。 那一般人呢会认为说，我们打坐呢可以入定，啊，有这种定力了，是没有错的。因为打坐呢在静中来修的时候，能够容易得到禅定。但是真正的这种禅定或是正定，是要动静中都要修的，动中也要有定力，静中也要有定力。所以呢，在我们生活中行、住、坐、卧。 在走路的时候呢，或是我们站的时候，或是我们坐的时候，或是我们躺下去睡觉，那这个叫做四种威仪，在四大威仪中呢，也可以同时呢会有正定的。那怎么保持我们的正定呢？比如说你平常打坐了，你觉得呢身心很安乐，你会妄想呢就少了很多。 可是呢，你在动中，你在做事情的时候，走路的时候，那是不是同样有定力呢？这个修行呢，不是说我打坐才有定力，那么我做事就没有定力了，那这个就不是真正的定力了。真正有定力的是在动静中或是行住坐卧都要有定力的。所以有一个譬喻就这样讲说呢，如果我们定中有十分的功夫，就是你打坐。 功夫很好了，你有十分的功夫了，可是呢，动中只有两分，啊，就被打折扣了。那你动中有功夫的时候呢，你呢这个在睡梦中呢，啊，这个功夫又要打折扣了。比如说你的动中有十分的功夫，在睡梦中，那个功夫又剩下两分了。那你呢，这个睡梦中。 也有定力了，比如说你睡梦中也可以念佛，你也可以有这种外界，就是说梦中有境界诱惑你了，你有定力，持戒不受诱惑，那有功夫了。可是呢，这些功夫到病中的时候还是要打折扣。在我们病痛的时候，人都是很苦的，这时候呢，很多那种定力呢都不见了。 为什么？因为那个病苦啊，胜过了我们的定力，所以呢，那个定力就消失了。所以呢，就讲到说，如果我们睡梦中有十分的功夫，那么在病中呢，又剩下两分了，又打折扣了。那如果我们病中有功夫，可是呢，这个功夫你也有十分的，那我们到临命中最苦最苦的时候呢，啊，那个功夫又剩下两分了。所以你想想看，从定中所修的功夫，如果在我们的日常生活中，我们经不住考验，那等到我们面临往生那一刹那的时候呢，啊，这个不见得真正会有定力的，因为呢，所有的修行呢，都是为这个往生最后一刹那来做准备的。中国人讲呢，叫做养兵千日，用在一朝。你养了一大堆军队啊，那做什么呢？就是等待有一天啊，它可以来用来保卫国家。一样的，我们人一生的修行呢，就是在啊临命中那一念就决定我们要往生去哪里。所以为什么我们念佛在临命中，如果我们能够还有定力，能够继续念佛，这个时候呢，佛会依照他的愿力来接引我们到西方极乐世界去。那就是因为你需要念佛。如果那个时候呢，你还是念着孩子、家庭、事业，啊，或是这个钱财，那保证呢一定回来继续轮回。所以呢，这个念力很重要。这个念力呢，平常呢，啊，就要好好的修行，等于说我们要去关照我们的念头。
Okay, so the next is the root of samadhi, and samadhi usually refers to dhyana or proper concentration. And so some people might think, well, when I meditate, I feel that I have some samadhi power, I can really concentrate. And so this is when you're in silence, you can obtain this kind of samadhi. Yes, that's a certain type of concentration. However, you must be able to concentrate or have samadhi power both when you're moving and when you're silent or when you're sitting down. And so that is why in the four different kinds of deportments, when you're walking, standing, sitting, and reclining, you must, in all these various actions, have proper concentration. And so usually most people, when they're meditating, they feel blissful, they feel very happy because they have much fewer false thoughts. But then you must ask yourself, when you're moving or when you're walking, do you have the same experience? Do you also have less false thoughts? And if you're not, then that means you're just having a concentration or a samadhi power when you're just sitting. You have not obtained to the point where you can have concentration power when you're both moving and in a dormant mode. And so that is why there is an analogy that goes, if you have some concentration power when you're sitting, so let's say you have 10 points, but then when you are moving, you only have 2 points. So it kind of reduces when you go on to a higher stage. So for sitting, 10 points, moving, only 2 points. And now if you, when you are moving, you have certain abilities and you have 10 points. However, when you are in a dream state or when you're entering a dream, that those points will also reduce and only become 2 points. Similarly, when you are dreaming, you have 10 points. Maybe in your dream, you can recite the Buddha's name or you can be conscious of and be able to deflect all types of enticements. However, when you are ill, this concentration power will reduce to 2 points because when you're ill, you have much suffering, and this suffering often surpasses your concentration. And so that is why it's much harder to maintain concentration when you're ill. And now finally, if you have 10 points when you're ill, at the end of your life, you only have 2 points. And so we see from here that to be able to have proper concentration is very important. And in our everyday lives, we must cultivate it, and we must be able to overcome the various tests that come before us. Because if at the end of our life, we're not able to concentrate, then everything is just wasted because we're performing all these various tasks in order to prepare for that moment at the end of our lives. And so that is why a Chinese saying goes, one has troops for 1,000 days. One gives the troops various foods and provisions in order for the battle of one morning. So it is just that major battle to protect one's country that is crucial, and that one wastes so many days and so many provisions to have these troops in order to fight that important battle. And so similarly for us, we have this last thought in our lives, which determines where we go. So if at the end of our lives, we can continue reciting the Buddha's name, then according to Amitabha Buddha's vows, he will come and bring us to the land of ultimate bliss. But at the end of our lives, if we still think of our families, our careers, our wealth, and our children, then inevitably we will have to continue revolving in the cycle of birth and death. So that is why our thoughts are very important, and we must start from now, from our daily lives, in order to prepare for that moment at the end of our lives. So this is the root of mindfulness, of samadhi.
这个定根呢，其实它跟念根是息息相关的，跟慧根也是息息相关的。我们知道这个三无漏学呢叫戒定慧，因戒生定，持戒了你就会有定力。 那么由定发慧，因为有定力了，就会有智慧。这个智慧从哪里来呢？这个智慧不是从外面来的，是我们本来就具有的。那么我们本具的智慧为什么不显现？就是因为我们没有定力。为什么我们没有定力？因为我们被贪嗔痴三毒这些呢妄想执着呢，把我们的智慧给 蒙蔽了，所以显现不出来。因此呢，我们要把我们的慧根扎得深一点，这个根深了以后呢，那这些三毒贪嗔痴的妄想就会少一点。所以呢，这五根呢，信、信、念、定、慧，五根呢，它会产生一种力量了，就因为根呢能够增长。 它呢，如果我们一直把它栽培的话，这个根就越来越深。那么它会产生一种力量，这个力量就变成叫武力，就是信力、静力、定力、念力、定力，还有慧力。这个力呢，就是产生一种功能跟作用，就是在我们修行上有这种信的力量，有这种精进的力量，有这种正念的力量，有这种禅定的力量。
So actually, the roots of samadhi, of mindfulness, and of wisdom, these three are connected intimately. Because if we know about the three non-outflow learnings, these are precepts, samadhi, and wisdom. And so because of precepts, we have samadhi. And because of samadhi, we give rise to wisdom. And so this wisdom, thus, is not from the outside. We do not obtain wisdom from the outside. It is inherent within us. And so that is why we are able to obtain this kind of wisdom. And this wisdom, in fact, is given to us, or we find it through our samadhi, through our concentration. So if we do not have concentration, then the three poisons of greed, hatred, and delusion, they will obstruct us, as well as false thoughts and attachments. And so by having our roots of wisdom becoming deeper and deeper, then the three poisons of greed, hatred, and delusion will become fewer and fewer. And so we see from here that the five roots, faith, vigor, mindfulness, samadhi, and wisdom, these are important roots. And if we can have the roots be planted deeply, then these roots will give rise to a type of power. And that is why the five roots give rise to the five powers, which are the power of faith, the power of vigor, the power of mindfulness, the power of samadhi, and the power of wisdom. So these powers are a kind of function which help us in our cultivation to have the power to have deep faith, to be vigorous, to give rise to proper thoughts, to have proper concentration, and to have wisdom. And in this way, we will be able to cultivate more easily.
那么菩萨所修的这些善根呢，它的目的是什么呢？皆为救护一切众生。菩萨不是用来自私自利的，他是为了救护一切众生。为什么众生需要救护呢？ 很多人觉得在我们这个世界上，我们也过得很快乐，但是呢，这个快乐不是究竟的，因为呢，这个世界上有很多的痛苦是在等到我们快乐完了以后，它就产生了。那生老病死苦，这是很难避免的。那么在《法华经》就讲到说呢，我们众生所居住的这个三界，就是欲界、色界、无色界。 这三界呢，就像一个大火燃烧的房子，所以叫做火宅。那么这个法华经就讲说呢，三界无安，犹如火宅。这个三界里头呢，是很不安全的，就像一个大火所燃烧的房子，有很多的这种苦逼迫着。可是呢，众生怎么样？不觉不知啊，他们都不知，没有觉悟到，说原来我们所住的这个娑婆世界。 或是三界里头呢，就像一个被大火所燃烧的房子，很快的我们就有这个火呢会烧上身了。那我们呢还自得其乐，在火宅里头呢玩得很高兴。那么可是这个佛呢已经知道我们呢有这些危险，所以呢他在教导众生或是菩萨行菩萨道的时候呢，就要说要救护一切众生。 把这个众生呢，从三界的火宅里头呢，把它救度出来，让他们能够呢离苦得乐，永远呢脱离六道轮回。否则呢，我们如果在三界里头轮回，你这一生苦受了，那么来生呢还是要再受。为什么？因为六道呢，它是一个轮回不休的，这辈子做人，下辈子也不保证做人，因为呢会根据我们的善恶业来决定我们的往生。 如果恶业做得多了，那会往生到地狱，或是恶鬼，或是畜生。如果善业做多了，还可以做人，还可以升天享天福，啊，或是到阿修罗道去。但是呢，福报享完了，一样堕落，那就是说这个六道跑来跑去呢，一直不能处理。所以呢，诸佛菩萨呢慈悯众生，他知道这个三界里头这么苦。 可是众生呢不觉不知，所以呢就要救护一切众生，因为呢所有的菩萨或是佛呢都是发大菩提心的，他们呢一定要行菩萨道才能够成佛。如果呢佛或是菩萨不行菩萨道，那么他们永远都不会成佛。因此呢，他要成佛一定有一个行菩萨道的对象，那就是众生。
Okay, so the Bodhisattva here is helping to protect all living beings. So this Bodhisattva is not selfish. He is using the good roots that he has cultivated for the sake of rescuing and protecting all living beings. So why do living beings require protection? It is because we feel happiness in our lives, and that is why we do not cultivate. However, there is much suffering in this world after we finish experiencing all this happiness. Because the sufferings of birth, old age, sickness, and death cannot be avoided. And in the Dharma Flower Sutra, it talks about how the three realms, the desire realm, the form realm, and the formless realm, are like a burning house. And in the Dharma Flower Sutra, it says that this is not a safe place, and it's just like a burning house that is being engulfed in flames. And the three realms are thus, it's a burning house, and there's much peril, there's much suffering that are oppressing living beings. However, living beings do not know that the three realms are like a burning house, and we're still playing happily within this house and unaware of everything that is occurring around us. However, the Buddha already knows that living beings are in much danger, and so he wants to save us from becoming burned or harmed, and for us to ultimately leave the revolving of the six paths. And so if we are unable to leave the three realms, then after we finish suffering this life, we will have to continue suffering in the next life, and it will continue on, and it will never end. So that is why we must leave the three realms and leave the revolving of the six paths quickly and not continue. Because if we are a person in this life, that does not guarantee that we will continue being a person in the next life. It depends on what kind of karma we create. If we create more evil karma, then we will fall into the hells, the hungry ghosts, and the animals. But if we do more good karma, then we might continue being a person we might rise to the realm of the Asuras or the heavenly beings. And so even though we might rise to the higher realms, maybe to becoming a heavenly being, eventually after we finish using up our blessings, we will still have to fall down and continue revolving the six paths. So that is why the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas, they are very compassionate and they pity living beings. They see that living beings do not know about their suffering or their danger. And thus, they give rise to the great Bodhi resolve, and they practice the Bodhisattva path in order to help living beings. And so this Bodhisattva path, every Bodhisattva and every Buddha had to practice, because if they never practiced this Bodhisattva path, then they never would have become Buddhas. And to practice the Bodhisattva path, they must have a person to save, or a living being to save. And these living beings are us people who are here suffering.
为什么这些诸佛菩萨要发菩提心，救护一切众生，利益一切众生，安乐一切众生，哀悯一切众生，或是成就一切众生，乃至要一切众生成佛呢？在普贤恨愿品就有一段经文讲得非常好，他用一个譬喻来说明为什么菩萨需要一个 行菩萨道的对象就是我们的众生。那个经文就这样讲，他说呢，譬如旷野杀气之中有大树王，若根得水，枝叶花果，悉皆繁茂；生死旷野菩提树王亦复如是。一切众生而为树根，诸佛菩萨而为花果。以大悲水饶益众生，则能成就诸佛菩萨智慧花果。 这段经文就讲说呢，譬喻说，在这种旷野或是在沙漠里头，有一个菩提树王。那这个呢，如果这个菩提树王呢，它的根部得到了水的滋润了，那么它呢枝叶花果就长得很繁茂。那么所以呢，在这种菩提道上也是一样，这个菩萨呢是以众生而为树根。 那么用大悲水来饶益所有的众生，就会成就诸佛菩萨的智慧花果，也就是让每个众生呢都能成就佛果。那么所以呢，就讲说呢，若无众生，一切菩萨终不能成就无上正等正觉。也就是说，如果离开了众生呢，菩萨就不能成佛。因此呢，菩萨必须要行菩萨道，他需要做种种利益众生的事情。
Okay, so here, the Buddhas and the Bodhisattvas, they are bringing forth the Bodhi resolve, and they are here rescuing and protecting all living beings, and they are bringing benefit to all living beings, making all living beings happy, and they are performing all this out of sympathy and pity for all living beings. They are here to bring all living beings to accomplishment, and all the way to bring all living beings to Buddhahood. And so we see here that why are the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, why are they performing all this for living beings? Well, in the Universal Goodness Bodhisattvas Conduct and Vows chapter, we see a very good analogy about why the Bodhisattvas need living beings in order to fulfill the practice of the Bodhisattva path. So the analogy basically goes that in an arid desert, there is a great king of Bodhi tree. And this tree, the roots receive nourishment of water, and then the fruits and the leaves and the branches, they're able to flourish because they also receive this kind of nourishment. Similarly, when the Bodhisattvas, they practice the Bodhisattva path, living beings are the roots, and the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas are the leaves and the fruits. And so because the living beings, they receive this nourishment, so that is why the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas can also grow. And so by allowing all living beings to achieve Buddhahood, the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas are helping themselves to also practice on their way. And so that is why if without living beings, the Bodhisattvas cannot become Buddhas, because they must have a person to save. They must have the living beings in order to, for themselves, to be able to become Buddhas.
那么菩萨呢，要怎么来行菩萨道呢？就要用行六波罗蜜 就是布施、持戒、忍辱、精进、禅定，还有智慧。那布施呢，有财施，用这种财来布施给众生，让呢众生呢离开贫穷困苦，或是用法施，啊，用以佛法来布施给众生，让他们能够啊离苦得乐，出离三界，得到究竟的安乐。要用无畏施来布施给众生，当众生有恐惧、有这种怖畏的时候呢，那么菩萨呢要施以无畏啊，就像观世音菩萨一样。所以在普门品就讲到说呢，啊，观世音菩萨是一个施无畏者。那么在娑婆世界，他就把这种无畏布施给所有的众生。所以众生呢，啊，听闻到观世音菩萨的圣号，或者是称念观世音菩萨的圣号的时候呢，那么呢，观世音菩萨就会寻声救苦，让他们离开这些恐怖啊，或是这种啊烦恼。
So how do the bodhisattvas practice the bodhisattva path? Well, they practice the six paramitas, which are giving, morality, patience, vigor, dhyana, and wisdom. So giving, there are three different types of giving. The first is that of wealth. And so the bodhisattva, they give various kinds of wealth to living beings, allowing living beings to leave their poverty and leave their suffering. Then we also have the giving of dharma, which is where the bodhisattvas allow living beings to obtain ultimate bliss by giving them dharma, this kind of transcendental teachings. And then there is the giving of fearlessness, which is where when living beings are in a mode of fear, when they're in a situation where they need help, then this bodhisattva will give the living being a kind of comfort and solace and allow them to become fearless. So this is just like how Guanxin Bodhisattva in the Universal Door chapter is able to give living beings fearlessness. So when living beings are in a situation where they are fearful or where they are oppressed, when they recite Guanyin Bodhisattva's name, then Guanyin Bodhisattva will come and bestow fearlessness and allow these living beings to leave their fear and afflictions.
那么菩萨呢要持戒波罗蜜，这个戒呢是无上菩提本。如果依照佛所制的戒律，那就是叫做诸恶莫作，众善奉行。所以呢，菩萨呢是只利益众生的。那么菩萨在持戒的过程中，最维系的戒，他都要持得好。所以在《梵网经》就讲到说，有一个故事是这样的，叫做草系比丘。有一群比丘呢，他们在野外的时候呢，遇到了一群这个强盗土匪，那么来打劫他们，把他们身上所有的东西呢全部呢搜刮走了，那么甚至把比丘的袈裟呢都给剥下来了，所以所有的比丘呢就身上没有衣服。本来有强盗呢还想把这个比丘全部给杀了，以免呢他们就杀人灭口，以免呢他们去跟官府报案。但是其中有一个强盗就讲说，我听说呢这些比丘呢都是很慈悲的，他们呢连这个这种草呢他们都不随便去伤害，更别说一些的其他的众生了。就说一些比丘呢，他们连这种比如说树枝这种野外的草，他们都不践踏，也不去伤害的。所以呢，这个强盗呢就说，那我们用这个野外这个草很长，我们就把这些比丘呢用这个草把他们捆绑起来，因为他们不伤害这些草，所以呢他们绝对呢不会去跟官府报案的，那么他们一定会就是饿死在这里，我们就不用杀他。那果然呢，这些被捆绑的比丘呢，他们因为不愿意去伤害这些草，所以呢，他们没有把这个草呢给折断，或是为了偷困来伤害这些草，他们呢就在这个旷野里头呢，就在那边呢忍受着。后来呢有人经过了，就把比丘给救了。那么这个事情 传到国王的耳中了，知道这些比丘为了持戒而连这些呢这草呢都不伤害，就把比丘呢请到王宫中去供养。所以呢这个菩萨呢在持戒的时候，你看他在很维系的，比如说无情的众生他都不伤害，何况是有情的众生。所以呢他的持戒是很清净的。
Okay, so the bodhisattvas, they also uphold precepts. And because precepts are the fundamentals of utmost bodhi, and so that is why these bodhisattvas must uphold precepts. And according to the Buddha, precepts are referring to not performing all evil and performing in accord with all good. So even the most subtle precepts, the bodhisattva must uphold very well because they are basically models for living beings. So in the Brahmanet Sutra, there is an analogy or a story about how there were a group of bhikshus and they were walking in the wilderness and suddenly they encounter some bandits. And these bandits rob them of everything they have, including their sashes. So now they have no clothes on and they have nothing with them anymore. And originally there was also another bandit who wanted to kill off all these bhikshus in order to prevent them from telling the officials about these bandits. But then there was one bandit that said, well, I heard that these bhikshus, they uphold the precepts very purely, and there is a precept that prevents them from harming even grass, even the plants. And so because these plants or grass, they're also in a way living, and so they cannot harm them. So I know what to do now. We can just tie them up and bundle them up with grass and roots. And then because they cannot harm these grasses and roots, then they will not be able to break free. And then eventually they will die of hunger. And so the bandits all agreed to do this. So then they tie them all up with grass and roots. And that's what they did. And sure enough, these bhikshus, they were tied up and they did not wish to escape from these grasses by breaking free because they were upholding the precepts very purely. And so they began to endure this pain, this suffering. And eventually somebody passed by and found them, and then he saved these bhikshus. So when the king heard about this story, and he heard how these bhikshus were able to uphold the precepts so purely, to not even harm these plants, these grass, so he brought all these bhikshus to his palace in order to make offerings to them. So we see from here that the bodhisattva even upholds the most subtle of precepts. And this includes not harming not only those living beings with blood and flesh, but also those living beings without emotion. And so that is why the bodhisattva must uphold the precepts very purely.
那么第三度叫忍辱波罗蜜。这个忍呢是很不容易的，因为在中文里头，这个忍是在我们的心上有一把刀，就是把一把刀呢插在你的心上，那表示呢是。很不容易忍的，你都要忍，不能忍的要忍。所以呢，这个忍不容易做到，而且这个辱就是有人呢侮辱你、毁谤你，或是呢这个批评你，都要能够忍受啊，这是一个忍辱的波罗蜜。那么忍呢是无价宝。那么上人说呢，忍是无价宝，人人死不好。那若能会用它，何愁到不了？就是说这个忍辱呢是一种宝，如果我们会用了，那一定能够呢修道会成功的。我们在这个经典上《金刚经》就看到佛在过去生中，他做这个忍辱仙人，被这个割力王呢割截尸体这个肢体，那么忍辱仙人呢都可以忍受，而且呢等到他成佛以后，第一个度的就是割力王，也就是佛的弟子焦成如比丘。那么佛呢在法华经第二十品也讲他过去前生呢就是常不清菩萨。常不清菩萨呢，他过去生中所行修行的法门就是礼拜的法门，他呢对所有的比丘、比丘尼或是优婆塞、优婆夷这些呢世众，只要看到了，那么常不清菩萨就会过去跟他们顶礼，然后说呢 我不敢轻视汝等，汝等皆当作佛。那意思说呢，我把你们每个人都当作未来佛一样的恭敬。可是呢，被恭敬的这些比丘或是比丘尼或是优婆塞优婆夷呢，他们不但是不生欢喜心，反而呢很生气，说呢，你算什么啊？你为什么来跟我们顶礼呢？你又不是佛，为什么你可以给我们受记，说我们就是佛呢？啊，你有什么资格呢？因此呢，很多人就轻视他。那轻视他呢，甚至用棍子打他，啊，或是石头来丢他。那么长期长不轻不善的，不跟他们对抗，他都可以忍受。那么如果有人呢要打他了，要骂他了，要用这个专头啊瓦片来丢他的时候，他就跑得远远的。可是，在远的地方，他还是一样，又对着这些人来叩头顶礼，然后又说呢，我不敢轻视汝等，汝等皆堪皆当作佛。所以呢，佛呢过去生中就是因为修这
Okay, so the third paramita is that of patience. And patience is not easy to practice because the Chinese character is that of a knife on a heart. So it is basically a knife going through a heart. It's that painful. And so for those things that are not easy to endure, we must still do so. And even for those things that we are unable to endure, we must still endure that kind of pain and suffering. So if somebody insults us or shames us or slanders us, we must still endure all these various insults. And that is why the Venerable Master has a verse that goes, "Patience is a priceless jewel that nobody knows how to use. But if we know how to use it, then everything will be smooth and successful." So if we are able to use patience, which is such a priceless jewel, then in our cultivation, it will go very smoothly. And so we see that Shakyamuni Buddha in his past lives, he also had to endure a lot of suffering. So we see the case of King Kali and the patient immortal. King Kali cut off all the limbs of the patient immortal as well as other body parts. But the patient immortal not only did not give rise to any kind of hatred, he also vowed to cross over King Kali when he became a Buddha. And so King Kali in the future was the Buddha's first disciple, Ajnata Kaundinya. And also in chapter 20 of the Dharma Flower Sutra, the Buddha in the past was never slighting Bodhisattva. So in the past, this Bodhisattva, he practiced bowing. And whenever he saw a Bhikshu, Bhikshuni, Upasaka, or Upasika, one of the four assemblies, he would go over and bow to that person. And then he would say, "I do not dare slight you." Why? Because you will become a Buddha in the future. However, when these Bhikshus, Bhikshunis, Upasakas, or Upasikas heard this, not only were they not happy, they also became very angry at being respected because they told him, "Hey, what are you telling me? You're not a Buddha yet. How can you bestow a prediction on me? You're just lying. Just get off with you." And so then they began slandering him, and they even used sticks and stones and tried to hit him. And so when somebody was about to hit him or slander him, Never Slighting Bodhisattva would go off to a distance. But even then, when he was at a distance, he would continue bowing to these people and telling them, "I do not dare slander you because you will become Buddhas in the future." So because Shakyamuni Buddha in the past was able to practice the paramita of patience, that is why in the Dharma Flower Sutra, he tells us living beings to also be like Never Slighting Bodhisattva and be able to endure and be patient.
佛有一位弟子叫富罗那弥多罗尼子，他是佛的弟子中呢，说法第一的。那这个富罗那呢尊者有一次他想发菩提心去到一个山区教化众生，那他就来请示佛，同时呢跟佛告别。佛就跟他说呢，我听说这个山区那边的人是很粗暴、很邪恶的。 你去了是很危险的，如果你去了，他们不听你的教导，那么他们来 来诽谤你，来骂你，那你会怎么样啊？这个富罗那尊者就说呢：如果他们来辱骂我，那我会觉得很高兴，因为呢，他们毕竟没有用这个拳头来打我，或是用棒子来打我，所以呢，我可以忍耐，我可以接受，我不会生嗔恨心的。那么佛就又问他。 如果他们打你，那你会怎么样？富罗那尊者又说了：如果他们用拳头或是呢用棍子来打我，我一样不会生嗔恨心，我还是会觉得很高兴。为什么呢？因为呢，他们并没有用刀子来杀我。那佛又问富罗那尊者说：如果他们用刀子来杀你？ 那你会觉得怎么样啊？富罗那尊者也会又回答说呢：如果他们这样做，他把我杀了，我一样我不生嗔恨心，我一样是很欢喜，因为呢，我早就知道我这个身体呢是四大假合的，终有一天要败坏。那他们把我杀了，我也不生嗔恨，因为呢这个身体不是一个究竟的，总有一天呢生老病死是每个人都要去面临的。 所以呢，我到那边呢，不管他们怎么对待我，我都可以忍受。那佛就说：“富罗那尊者，富罗那，你现在呢，可以去那边教化众生了。”所以当尊者到那边去了以后呢，本来那边的人一开始呢是很不听教的，那么他们跟尊者起很多对待，可是因为尊者呢是修了这种忍辱的法门，所以呢以后。 这里的人呢，都受他的教化，有500个人呢，也跟着他一起来修道了。那么尊者呢，也在这个山区里头呢，他能够呢，证得了他的这种阿罗汉果。Okay,
so the Buddha had a disciple called Purna Maitreya Putra, and this disciple was foremost in speaking Dharma. And so once this disciple, he wanted to go to the mountain regions in order to teach and transform living beings. So then he went to ask the Buddha. The Buddha then said, well, these living beings in the mountains, they are very evil, they're very coarse, they're very mean. So if you go and they do not listen to you, and not even that, they also yell or slander you, what will you do? And then Purna replied, saying that if they slandered me, then I will be very happy because I will think, well, they did not use fists or clubs to hit me, and so I will not become angry. Then the Buddha said, if they hit you, what will you do? And then Purna replied, if they use fists and clubs to hit me, I will also not become angry because I will think, they have not used knives to kill me yet. The Buddha then said, if they use knives to kill you, then what will you do? Then Purna replied, saying that if they use knives to kill me, I will also give rise to no hatred, and I will still be happy, because I know that this body is made of the four elements. It is a false body, and it is impermanent, and everyone has to encounter birth, old age, sickness, and death, and so I will happily face death. And so when the Buddha heard this, he then told Purna, saying that, yes, indeed, you can go and transform the beings of the mountain regions. So then Purna went to the mountains to begin crossover living beings. And at first, these people also, they did not listen and they performed various kinds of treatments towards Purna. But gradually, because Purna was able to endure all these various kinds of treatments, these people transformed and 500 people even followed Purna in studying under the Buddha. And also in the mountain regions, Purna was able to achieve arhatship.
那么菩萨所修的第四度叫精进波罗蜜，就像一开始我讲的，这个精进呢是要身精进，心也要精进。那么第五度叫禅定禅波罗蜜，就是要有定力，有正定。我们佛教徒所修的这种禅定是一种叫正定正受。为什么要讲正定呢？因为有别于外道的这种 邪定，有些外道他也修禅定，但是他的禅定呢，因为他的心念是偏的，所以他修出来这种定 也是一种偏的，是一种邪的。那么佛教呢，因为我们有正知正见，所以呢所修的禅定也是一种正定。那么第六度叫般若波罗蜜，般若波罗蜜呢它有三种，所以我要讲多一点点。
Okay, so the fourth paramita that the Bodhisattva practices is vigor. And so just like I said previously, we must be vigorous in both body and mind. So then the fifth paramita is that of dhyana. And so in Buddhism, the dhyana concentration is having proper concentration and reception. And this is different from deviant concentration of the externalists, because these externalists, although they practice and they also have a certain type of concentration, however, their thoughts or their minds stray away from the proper path. And so that is why, because Buddhists, they have this kind of proper knowledge and views, they also have a kind of proper concentration. And now finally, we have the sixth paramita of prajna or wisdom, and this comes in three kinds.
这个般若呢是梵语，它在翻译上叫五不翻里头是属于叫多含不翻，就是说般若呢有多种的含义，所以呢就不翻，它只翻音不翻字，翻字不翻音，就是说。般若呢是梵文的音，那这个音呢我们不翻，那只是把那个梵文的字翻成中文，所以呢我们还是读成般若。这个般若呢有三种意思，第一个叫文字般若，第二个叫观照般若，第三个叫实相般若。这个文字般若呢是什么？像我们所研读的这种经典都属于文字般若，或是你们所看的上人的开示，不管是中文的、英文的、越南文的，都属于叫文字般若，是用文字来表达的一种智慧。本来这个般若是翻译叫做智慧，但是如果把它翻译成智慧，不能完全表达这个般若的意思，所以就不翻。那么如果再以文字这种般若文字的智慧来讲，像现在大家一起来研究经典，那么你们在听这个华严经，透过这种语言跟文字，你所得到的都叫做文字般若。从文字般若呢，你就了解，哦，原来这就是佛法。可是文字般若是不是一个究竟的佛法呢？不是的，它是一个方便法。就是说，佛法本来是很深很妙的，它离开这个语言文字，离言说相，就是说它呢不是语言跟文字所能表达的，但是呢佛因为很慈悲，他要度化众生，所以呢必须用语言跟文字把它表达出来，那么就变成一个文字般若。这文字般若呢就像什么呢？我们是小孩子，还没有读过书，不认识字，所以呢你就要去上小学，到小学呢你要接受基础的教育，等到对这个佛法有一个概略的了解，从文字般若上或是听经闻法学习到佛法以后呢，就开始要起观照般若。怎么观照呢？就是我们的心呢不是往外持求了，我们的六根也不是往外持求了，我们的这种六根要收摄起来，我们的心呢也要起观照，就是观照我们的什么呢？观照我们的起心动念，在每一个念头生出来或是还没有生出来，我们就能够察觉出来了，那就是一个观照波了。所以这个观照波了，当我们一个恶念一产生的时候，我们就像什么，那个观照的力量就像一只猫一样，它呢发现一只老鼠，从那个老鼠洞出来了，那个念头呢一生你马上就察觉到了，那就是一个观照波了。所以如果我们观照到了恶的念头，马上让它不生那个恶念呢就不要再继续生了，已生的这种恶念呢你就要让它灭了要断了。那么如果这个念呢你观照它是一个善的念，你就要让它增长，善念继续增长。所以这样的话，你呢这个你的念头呢，每个念头就是一种善的，你不会恶念呢 让这个恶念来滋长，那就是一种观照波罗。所以这个观照波罗其实呢，就是一个比较深的波罗了，就比较深的智慧，那是一个内观的智慧。那这个内观的智慧，它首先呢，要我们的六根，就是我们的眼根、耳根、鼻根、舌根，还有我们的身根，还有我们的意根，都不能向外持求。这外边呢，因为有六尘，就是色、声、香、味、触、法。也就是说，我们的眼睛对着对着色啊，眼睛呢，你见到了颜色，就产生种种这种分别或是贪爱。看到你喜欢的这个美色，你就产生了喜欢或是贪心了贪爱这种美色。但你看到不喜欢的，当然你会产生一种厌恶，就是开始做分别了。耳朵听到声音也是一样的，耳听到美妙的声音，你也会生贪爱。你听到你不喜欢的声音，你也会产生厌恶，那就是一种分别。所以鼻子也是一样，鼻子呢闻到香味了，也产生一种所谓这种贪或是厌恶的心理。那么舌根，你尝到味道了就是说你把东西呢送到你的口中，你吃了也会对这种味起一种分别。我们的身根也是一样的，我们身体呢碰到柔软的我们就喜欢，碰到那些出色的我们就产生厌恶的心理。或是呢天气好的时候我们觉得很舒服，天气冷热我们的身体跟这个外界的空气接触就产生一种这种不舒服的感觉，那都是一种分别。那么我们的意根也是一样，当我们意根，我们听到一句话，我们呢思维一个事情，我们也会产生种种喜欢或是呢厌恶的心理。其实呢，这些我们的六根对着六尘这种境界就产生叫做六识，就是分别。因为你有分别呢，所以呢这个分别呢就不是智慧。在佛教讲呢，我们的眼耳鼻舌身意对着六尘色声香味触法以后，就产生六识了，就是眼识、耳识、鼻识、舌识、身识、意识。这个六识是什么？识是一种了知分别，它是怎么样要转的？因为如果识的话，那就是一种世间的这种聪明才智，它不是真正的智慧。所以呢，在佛教佛法里头呢，教导我们要转识成智，把这个事呢转变成智慧。那这是一个就要从这种所谓观照波罗开始修起了，就是当我们察觉到我们这种眼睛我们的六根对着六尘产生种种分别的时候，当下我们就能够把这种事转成个智慧，去观照它到底这个我们这个在贪爱的是谁，或是呢我们是厌恶的是谁。你知道那是一个一种因缘所生的法，就是说因为有因缘，它是有生有灭的，有生灭的法就是不究竟的法。那不究竟的法它不是一个常，所以呢那个我们不能产生贪爱。因为呢你产生贪爱呢就是一个执着，有执着呢，那你这个就会被境界手转。如果我们能够知道怎么去观照我们的心让它呢不要到处这种向外持求的时候呢，我们这个六根就可以收摄起来。当我们六根收摄，我们要念佛，或是我们要持咒，或是我们要诵经，这个时候呢都会很专一了。因为呢修行是以专一为主，所以呢叫做自心一处，把心呢专一了，自心一处，无事不办，那这个修行呢就会成就了。所以这个观照波罗呢就显得非常重要。如果我们学习佛法只是在文字波罗上懂了很多比如说你对佛法了解很多，你也会背诵很多经典，也会念很多咒，可是呢那还是在一种文字波罗上。这个文字波罗你一定要呢进一步把它呢再转化成叫观照波罗。因为有观照波罗，最后我们才能够证得实相的波罗，那是真正佛的智慧。也就是说我们要真正得到佛的智慧呢，从最初步的文字波罗这个小学开始，接着呢我们要进入中学，就是观照波罗，接着进入大学的时候呢就是一个实相波罗阶段。 但是所谓小中大学呢，只是一个譬喻而已。只是说，在修行的次第上，如果你已经学了很多的佛法，那么就要更学习怎么起这个观照波了。
Okay, so prajna, there are three different kinds, and because prajna is not translated, because it is contains many meanings, and that is why only the words are conveyed, not the sound. And so the three meanings of prajna are literary prajna, contemplative prajna, and real mark prajna. So literary prajna refers to the sutras that we investigate, or when we read the Venerable Master's commentaries, maybe in Vietnamese or English or Chinese, or when we use languages to represent a wisdom. These are all types of literary prajna. And so originally, prajna was translated as wisdom, but because wisdom could not convey the full meaning of the word prajna, so that is why it was not translated. So if everyone here, we are investigating together the Buddha's Flower Garland Sutra, and we are now using sounds and words to understand this literary prajna. However, is this literary prajna the ultimate prajna, the ultimate wisdom? Well, it is not ultimate, because actually the Buddha's Dharma is apart from all words, and it's apart from all languages, and apart from all modes of speaking. And so the Buddha, originally his Dharma, he cannot really express it with words. However, he was very compassionate, and he forcefully used words in order to express the Dharma to us living beings. And so we are just like young children who do not know anything, and then we enroll into elementary school, and we are gradually able to obtain some knowledge about the language and about the various things that are around us. And after we have this kind of basic knowledge, then we can enter contemplative prajna. So contemplative prajna refers to how when we gather in our six organs, return the six organs within, and then we have our mind to contemplate our every thought. So when our every thought, when it's rising or when it's not rising, then we contemplate it. And we see if there's an evil thought that is rising. And if there's an evil thought that's rising, then we use the power of contemplation, just like a cat that immediately spots a mouse that is emerging from a hole. We are that cat, and we pounce on that mouse. And so we are able to use this power of contemplation and to stop the evil thought from arising. And if the evil thought has already arisen, then we extinguish that evil thought. So in this way, we stop all evil thoughts from arising or prevent them from continuing to arise, and then we allow all good thoughts to continue growing and flourishing. So in this way, every thought that we have is good, and then we can practice this kind of contemplative prajna, which is in fact deeper than literary prajna, is more inherent, and it is a contemplative wisdom. And so in order for us to have this contemplative prajna, we need our eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body, and mind to stop seeking from the outside. And so these six sense organs, they seek the six sense objects, which are forms, sounds, smells, tastes, objects of touch, and dharmas. So when these six sense organs encounter the six objects, then they give rise to attachments, to distinctions, and maybe to kinds of feelings of love or hatred. So maybe if our eyes see a beautiful form, then we give rise to love. But then if we see an ugly form, then we give rise to dislike. And similarly for our ears, if we hear wonderful sounds, then we like it. But then if we hear cacophonous sounds, then we dislike it. Our nose, if we smell fragrant smells, then we like it. And for our tongue, if we taste delicious tastes, then we'll also give rise to a favorable feeling. For our body, if we feel soft things, then it will like it. But then if we feel coarse things, then it will dislike it. If the weather is good, if the weather is just right, the body will feel good. But then if it's too cold or too warm, the body will give rise to a feeling of discomfort. And the mind also, when we are thinking something, we also distinguish between whether or not we like it or we dislike it. So in general, when these six sense organs encounter the six sense objects, then the six consciousness arise, and then we give rise to distinctions, not wisdom. So that is why in Buddhism we say that when the six sense organs, the eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body, and mind, encounter or come into contact with the six objects, which are forms, sounds, smells, tastes, objects of touch, and dharmas, then the six consciousnesses arise, which are the consciousnesses of the eyes, ears, nose, tongue, body, and mind. So these consciousnesses are merely understandings. We must turn these worldly knowledge to, we must turn this consciousness to wisdom. And so that is how we begin our practice of contemplative prajna. So we realize that when the six sense organs encounter the six sense objects, we are all merely making distinctions. And so we must have wisdom in order to stop ourselves from making various kinds of distinctions. And so by contemplating, we will prevent ourselves from thinking, oh, who do we like or who do we dislike? And in this way, we will realize that contemplation, that these six organs and the six objects, it is merely a dharma of causes and conditions. And this dharma of causes and conditions is merely the dharma of birth and death, which is not ultimate and it is impermanent. And then this dharma of birth and death, we cannot give rise to any kinds of love or hatred towards it, because that is merely attachments towards impermanent things. And then if we are attached to it, then we will be turned by states. So we must allow ourselves to not become attached to these various different kinds of states. And by gathering in the six organs, we are able to better recite the Buddha's name. We're better able to recite mantras and recite sutras. And when we have the mind within a single place, then everything can be accomplished. So the contemplative prajna is very important, because if we only have literary prajna, then all we do is understand the sutras. All we do is memorize the sutras and memorize mantras. But we must change this literary prajna towards contemplative prajna, because that is going towards another level. We are now contemplating what these sutras or what these mantras say. And then finally, we go on to real mark prajna, which is the ultimate prajna of the Buddha. And so this is kind of like the analogy of how we start off from elementary school, and then we go on to middle and high school, and then finally we go on to university. However, this is only analogy, because we see now that even though we know a lot from literary prajna, we must ultimately turn it and allow it to become contemplative prajna in order to continue in our cultivation. So that is why contemplative prajna is so important.
上人教导一个很好的法门，可以收摄我们的六根，那就是眼观鼻，鼻观口，口问心，就是我们在打坐的时候呢。 我们的眼睛可以下垂，闭目三分，然后观着我们的鼻尖。我们的鼻尖呢，就来观着我们的口。我们的口呢，上人是说不是观心，它叫做口问心，因为那是参禅的法门。那这个法门其实是很好的，因为它不只是在打坐的时候可以用。我们在走路的时候，如果在不是人车很多的地方， 我们也可以用这样的法门来修行，或是呢，我们日常生活中也可以随时呢用这种眼观鼻、鼻观口、口问心的方式来修行，因为呢这样很容易收摄我们的六根。用这个方法呢，我们的眼根、我们的耳根、鼻根、舌根、我们的身根、意根都很容易呢专注，不会呢向外直求。那么 当然这平常要练习，它最好的方式就是在打坐的时候，你可以好好练习。那我相信呢，如果我们用这种方法来练习，在观照波罗上一定可以相应的。
So the Venerable Master, he taught a Dharma door, which allows us to very easily gather in the six organs. So this Dharma door is for our eyes to contemplate the nose, for our nose to contemplate the mouth, and for our mouth to ask the mind. So basically, maybe when we are meditating, we can have our eyes droop down basically close our eyes a little and look at the tip of our nose. And then our nose looks at our mouth or contemplates the mouth. And the mouth does not contemplate the mind. Instead, the mouth asks the mind, which is a kind of Dharma door for the Chan school. And this is not only good for meditation, it is also good when we are walking. So if there are not too many cars or people, we can also use this kind of method in order to practice. And also in general, in everyday life, we can use this Dharma door for our cultivation. And so in this way, our eyes, our ears, our nose, tongue, body, and mind, they will be gathered in and they will not go out and seek. And of course, in order to attain to this state, we must often practice this method. And in this way, it can allow us to be more in accord with contemplative prajna.
我们今晚华严经就到这里告一段落，不晓得各位有没有什么问题。 他讲到翻字不翻音，他的声音没有改变，音还是那个音没有改变，所以是翻把那个梵文的字翻成中文，所以叫做翻字不翻音。
Okay, so there was a question I was asking about the word prajna and when it's translated, what is translated and what remains the same, and so. The answer is that only the word is translated, the word prajna is translated, and not the sound. 所以明天本来应该有一个整天的念佛的法会，但是被延迟到了12月8号，所以如果你想参加的话，请等到12月8日再来参加，我们明天不会有这个法会。 Okay, so the announcement was that the Buddha recitation Dharma Assembly that was supposed to occur tomorrow was postponed until December 8th. And so there will be no full day recitation tomorrow. And for those who wish to come, please come next week. Okay, 所以两个星期之后，我们会在万佛圣城有一个佛期，所以就是两个礼拜。然后如果有人愿意参加的话，你可以参加全程或者一个星期或者甚至一天都可以，就是看你自己方便，然后就可以去多多参加。Okay, so there will be a two-week Buddha recitation session at the City of 10,000 Buddhas. And for those who wish to attend, you can attend for the full time for 2 weeks. Or if you have less time, then you can attend for 1 week or just for 1 day. Just see how much time you have available.